Hi, I'm Dr. Stramer, board certified family medicine and sports medicine doctor. In this video, we're going to discuss how insulin 70-30 injections work. Okay, without further ado, let's get started. So I have a lot of patients with type 2 diabetes who take these injections. It is becoming very uncommon for type 1 diabetes, basically insulin dependent diabetes, to take these injections, but it's still common among type 2 diabetes. And I've had a lot of patients who have been on these injections and they have come off these injections completely by incorporating lifestyle modification, basically regular exercise and healthy eating habits. For example, recently I had a patient who was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes, but he actually had a complication called as diabetic ketoacidosis, which was a presenting symptom of a diagnosis of type 2 diabetes. I had to start him on this particular injection because his A1C was really high, but then eventually, as he made those lifestyle modifications, he's been doing well without insulin and he's been just taking metformin and he's been doing fine. So understanding how it works is crucial if you're using insulin 70-30, regardless of whether you have type 1 diabetes, basically insulin dependent diabetes, or type 2 diabetes. So once you understand this insulin, you can effectively manage its dosage during exercise or when attempting to reduce the dose as you make those lifestyle changes. So before discussing about insulin 70-30, let's first understand how insulin works in our body. So insulin is an anabolic hormone. Basically, it means that it builds tissues. So too low of insulin is bad, as well as too much of insulin can also be bad. Our blood sugar tries to stay between 70 to 140 milligram per deciliter. When our blood sugar goes low, our stress hormones, called as the cortisol, and the other hormones, called as the glucagon, it tells the liver to pour some glucose into the blood. So these hormones also helps to burn fat for energy if needed. So the insulin always makes sure that it keeps in check to make sure that the fat is not being excessively burned to produce too much of ketone bodies. Ketone bodies are good. They are a good source of energy. But then too much ketone bodies can actually develop a complication called as ketoacidosis. Again, this is going to be uncommon in normal people. However, in diabetes patients, when they have a completely lack of insulin, especially in type 1 diabetes, they can develop a complication called as a ketoacidosis. In addition to that, the insulin also keeps a check on the liver. So let us say if the liver is not behaving properly with the insulin, then the liver starts to pour too much glucose in the bloodstream and thereby causing your blood sugar to increase. So there's always circulating insulin in our body at a low level, keeping this in check so that not too much ketone bodies are being produced. As you mentioned now, in type 1 diabetes, because of complete insulin deficiency, these ketone bodies production may not be kept in check, thereby resulting in the risk of diabetic ketoacidosis, which is a very dangerous complication. Unfortunately, I've seen a handful of deaths because of this condition in my clinical practice. So the diabetic ketoacidosis is a rare complication in type 2 diabetes. However, in some people, they might have severe insulin resistance, but it basically means that these fat and the liver tissues are not obeying insulin at all, and thereby it results in the increased production of ketone bodies and thereby resulting in the increased risk for ketoacidosis. So when we eat food, our blood sugar goes up. When we are stressed, our blood sugar goes up. Our pancreas will produce insulin to keep our sugars under control between 70 to 140. So what this means is that in a non-diabetic person, let us say if he's under stress, maybe due to poor sleep or work stress, his stress hormones will increase his blood sugar. However, his normally functioning pancreas will keep his sugar under control by producing excess insulin. So in addition, it's important to understand that during early morning, around between like 2 to 4 or even like 2 to 6 a.m., there is increased production of these two hormones called as the cortisol and the growth hormone, and these hormones increase the blood sugar. So these spike in blood sugar varies between different ages. For example, in growing kids during the time of puberty and stuff, so these hormones are being increased and thereby causing an increase in blood sugar spike. However, when someone has a normally functioning pancreas, they will produce excess insulin to compensate for this increased blood sugar that comes from these hormones. So in summary, what we have seen so far is that there is always low levels of insulin that is circulating in our body at all times. So this makes sure that the insulin keeps a check on the liver so that the liver is not pouring extra glucose into the bloodstream. The liver also keeps a check on the fat tissues so that not too much of ketone bodies are being produced. Otherwise, everybody can go into the risk of ketoacidosis. So in addition to that, we have also seen that during increased stress and during food intake, our blood sugar rises, and a normally functioning pancreas will produce extra insulin to make sure that the blood sugar stays between 70 to 140 milligram per deciliter. So the insulin 7030 is basically an older insulin, and I like this insulin for two reasons. So one is the cost. So let us say if my patient is not able to afford insulin because of not a good insurance, then they can actually buy this particular insulin for less than $25 in Walmart. In addition to that, people like this insulin because it's only two injections per day. So some of the examples of brand name insulin 7030 that are currently in the market involves the Novolog Mix 7030, Humalog Mix 7030, and Humalin Mix 7030. So let us first understand the insulin 7030. So when we say 30, it means that 30% of the insulin is actually made up of short acting. And the short acting can be either regular insulin, or it could be a rapid acting insulin such as insulin lispro or aspart. Whereas the 70% is actually going to be intermediate acting insulin. And then the intermediate acting insulin can be either NPH, or basically this particular insulin is kind of changed to act like NPH. So the key difference between whether there's a short acting insulin such as a regular insulin or the rapid acting insulin is that the regular insulin, it takes almost like 30 minutes to start acting, and it peaks at the around 2 hour mark, and then the insulin action lasts for almost 6 hours. Whereas when you have a rapid acting insulin, it starts to act very quickly. So it starts to act around like 15 minutes or so, and it peaks around like 1 hour or so, and it finishes acting by around 4 hours. So the key difference here is that if your insulin 7030 injection actually has a regular insulin, then you want to make sure that you take the insulin on 15 to 30 minutes before meal. Whereas let us say if you're going to take a rapid acting insulin, then around like 10 to 15 minutes before meal is more than enough. Now let us talk about how the NPH insulin, which is basically the intermittent acting insulin in the insulin 7030 works. So basically we're going to talk about the 70 part of that insulin. So basically here, the NPH, it starts to act around like 1 hour or so. And after that, it peaks around 4 to 8 hours, but it doesn't have that acute peak like the rapid or the short acting insulin has. So basically it has a peak around like 4 to 8 hours, and it lasts for almost up to like 12 to 16 hours or so. So now let's take an example, okay? So I'm going to take 8 units of 7030 insulin in the morning. So let's say I'm at here 8 o'clock, okay? So I'm going to have a good breakfast. So let's say I'm going to eat maybe like 2 to 3 toast with eggs, okay? So then I'm taking 8 units of insulin 7030, which means that the 30% of that insulin is going to cover my breakfast. So it peaks and comes back down almost by around like 12 o'clock or so. But at the NPH, it starts to act after like 1 hour, and it just goes, and it starts to peak. Again, not a peak like this, but kind of a smaller peak around 1 o'clock to around like 3-4 o'clock or so. So let us say you eat lunch here. So let us say an example that you eat lunch like maybe like rice, fried rice. Okay, so let us say you eat a fried rice. So the fried rice will actually cause a big spike in blood sugar, but however, the NPH doesn't have a peak like the short acting does, and thereby there's a chance that people can have a high sugar during this time at the lunch. So again, the insulin works until like around like 9 o'clock or so. So let us say you have dinner around like 7 p.m. or so. So let us say you're having dinner, and let's assume that you're going to have pasta for dinner. So pasta with chicken. So what happens here is that, again, you take, so let us say I'm injecting again with around like 6 units of insulin 7030. So which means that the 30% of the insulin will help me to cover the pasta, the dinner. And then the 70% of the insulin, which is the NPH, that's going to start working around like, maybe around like 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock or so. And then it's just going to work the whole night, and thereby providing somewhat of insulin at night. So the NPH will start to peak around between like 12 to 4 or so. And during that time, there's risk of a low blood sugar symptom. But let us say if someone has an increased stress during the morning, like we talked about. So for example, in like growing kids, if the blood sugar spikes in early morning, this particular insulin actually does a pretty good job in covering that spike in blood sugar. And this NPH will stop acting around like 6 a.m. to 8 a.m. or so, and then the cycle repeats. So what this means is that, so let us say if your morning blood sugar, so let us say your morning blood sugar here, you wake up in the middle of the night around 3 a.m. and your blood sugar is like 65, then that means that you have to focus on cutting back on your nighttime insulin. But let us say around mid-afternoon, your blood sugar drops to around like 65 or so, then you want to make sure that you cut back on your morning insulin. So the problem here is that, so let us say you're not able to eat a proper lunch in the afternoon, which is why your sugar drops. But then let's say if you have a pretty heavy breakfast in the morning, so once you cut back the morning insulin, then you might have some problems with high blood sugar during breakfast because you're not giving enough insulin to cover the breakfast because you're worried about a blood sugar crash during the afternoon. And same thing goes here too. So let us say if you're worried about the NPH insulin dropping your morning blood sugar, and then if you drop your insulin, but then let's say if you have a heavy dinner, then again you run into the risk of high blood sugar at night because you're not providing enough the shot or the rapid acting insulin to cover your dinner. So again, this is the problem with the insulin 70/30, is that it does not mimic how our pancreas work. But however, if you make some slight changes in your eating habits, this insulin 70/30 really works well. Again, in people with type 2 diabetes, once you start to make those lifestyle modifications, you'll be able to easily start to titrate the dose down and thereby able to get off the insulin completely as you make those lifestyle changes. However, unfortunately, in type 1 diabetes, they still have to continue the insulin for the rest of their life. And again, this insulin works well, except that, again, if you don't have any financial constraints and stuff, then I would recommend to switch to more like a long-acting as well as a short-acting insulin, which is kind of more like how our body functions primarily. So, but let us say you want to keep it cheaper and you don't want to invest into the newer insulin injections. There are some ways that you can, there are some approaches that you can do to make this injection still work. So let's say, for example, that you're having a heavy breakfast, but then let's say your work is not flexible, it can be unpredictable, and sometimes you can miss lunch and you're worried about early afternoon crash. So what you can do is that you can lower down your morning insulin injection, basically the 70/30 injection in the morning. But then for the heavy breakfast, you can add just the regular insulin. And I know that regular insulin is also cheap, like the insulin 70/30 injections. So you can add a little bit of regular insulin to cover the breakfast, but then that regular insulin is not going to crash your afternoon blood sugar. So this approach can be helpful. And the same thing goes for your dinner too. So let us say if you're worried about a blood sugar crash in the early morning, then you can add some amount of regular insulin to cover for the heavy dinner, and thereby you're not worried about the early morning crash. But again, that defeats the purpose where you're taking 2 injections per day. Now you have to take 3 to 4 injections per day. But again, the thing is that let's say if you have financial constraints, this approach is helpful because it works cheap. The other ideal way is to make sure that you eat some amount of carbs during your lunchtime, but then make sure that you're not eating a lot of high glycemic carbs and also trying to maintain your glycemic load, which I've covered a separate video on that topic, and I'm going to link the video above, okay? So make sure that you have a low glycemic load food here so that your blood sugar doesn't spike, but at the same time, the blood sugar still stays in a range where the blood sugar doesn't crash here. And the same thing goes for dinner. I think overall, my approach for dinner would be to make sure that you keep your insulin injections at a lower dosage. At the same time, you're also not eating a lot of carbohydrates so that you can start to focus on losing weight, and at the same time, you can cut back and basically lower the insulin dose, and slowly we can just come off the insulin. Okay, I hope this video is helpful. So the next video that I'm going to cover in the future is that how to exercise with insulin 70/30 and how to adjust the dose as you make those lifestyle modifications, okay? So to make sure that you don't miss that video, please make sure that you hit the subscribe button and the notification button. And if you find this video helpful, please make sure you hit the like button, and I'll see you in the next video. Until then, goodbye.